Now we have, I have already tested this, so I'm not running once again. Now we have developed the code with by externalizing the properties, and now it is ready to be deployed on the production cluster, which is our lab. Okay, so I'm saving this, and then I need to FCP. So here I have to right click on this and then copy path. So as Python is an interpreter programming language, we don't need to build into a jar file. But we might have to build a zip file if you have too much of code. But in this case, I'm just copying the directory directly. So I'm going to the parent directory of this project, and then I'm saying fcp-r bootcamp PySpark, okay, to training at gw02.itversity.com. gw02.itversity.com is nothing but gateway node for my 10 node cluster. And tilde is my home directory in that, and I'm copying the entire directory into my gateway node with that name itself. As the code is copied, now I can say training at gw02.itversity.com. Okay. Now we are actually getting into the deployment cycle. The development cycle is done. We have developed the code. We have validated locally, and we are now ready to deploy. And as part of the deployment cycle, first we copied the code onto the cluster, and then we'll be running it. Okay. So to run it, you can use Spark Submit on the lab. Okay. Just give me a moment. And as part of this deployment lifecycle, I will be covering very, very important concepts. Okay. It will take around 15 to 20 minutes, but they are very, very important concepts, and you need to understand these things. Okay. So once the code is copied onto the cluster, that means we are ready to run or schedule on the cluster. And the way you can run on the cluster is by using Spark Submit. And if you just say Spark Submit and hit enter, you will actually see, it will actually give you all the different runtime arguments which you can use. Okay. So here we are trying to run our Python application, right? Python is an interpreter based programming language. We don't need to use class here. Okay. We just have to give the Python application path, and then we have to pass the arguments. Before giving the Python file name and the arguments, such as prod in this case, we have to specify properties such as master so that we can run in YARN mode, and then we have to use deploy mode where we have to specify either client or cluster. So in this case, we'll be specifying as client. YARN can run in either client or cluster mode. I will explain what is that at a later point in time. Okay, so these two are the things which are important. On top of that, using conf, I'll be setting up I will be configuring a unique port for our Spark job, and we will see the default behavior, and then we will actually try to understand the different other properties which can improve the performance of our job. Okay, first we'll see the default behavior with minimal properties, and then we will actually explore all the important properties. So here, first to validate, I can say Spark Submit -- master YARN. Okay, and then deploy mode client. So I want to run it in client mode. Then conf spark.ui.port equal to 12901, and then one more conf where I'll be disabling Spark dynamic allocation. On our cluster, it is enabled. Generally, it is disabled by default, but in our cluster, we have enabled it for certain valid reasons. I will explain those valid reasons at a later point in time. But as it is enabled, I'm first disabling it to give the default behavior, and then we will take it from there. Okay, that's why we have to use this additional property. And then we have to run this job, we have to be in the working directory. As I'm not in the working directory, I'm killing this here, and then I'm actually going to the working directory, which is nothing but, what is the directory name? I think bootcamp PySpark. So this is our working directory, and now I'm saying Spark Submit master YARN deploy mode client, and then conf spark.ui.port equal to 12901, and then conf spark.dynamic allocation.enabled equal to false. Okay, now you have to give the relative path from this location for our Python application, which is nothing but source main Python retail DB, and then dailyrevenue.py, and we want to run it in prod mode, and hence I'm giving prod as argument. And hit enter. As Spark Nether version is already set to 2 as part of my profile, it is running in Spark 2.3, but it is using Python 2.7. As I have Python 2.7 on my PC, I have used that to run this code, and hence it will work. Okay. You can also use Python 3.5. Whatever APIs we have used with respect to Python does not change between 2.7 and 3.5, and you can validate. And you can see there are no exceptions anywhere. Everything looks fine. Okay. Now I can actually go to the output directory, which is nothing but user training bootcamp PySpark, and then daily revenue app 01. This is the output path which we have given. You can see the four files. Okay. Why there are four files? Let us see. Let us understand why it has generated four files, and then we can take it from there. So to understand this, we have to go to the web UI of our resource manager. Okay. So here I'm saying rm01.itversity.com 19288, and this is the one which I have ran. I'm going to history here. Once it is completed, it will be redirected to history tracking URL, and then you can see the stages and all those things. You can click on this, okay, and each one of these things are running using four tasks. Okay, I don't know why it is using four tasks. Ideally, it should be using only two by default, but for some reason it was using four tasks. Let me check the executors. It will give some idea. Okay. There are only two executors. I think in Spark 2.3, within each executor, it will be using two to tasks by default. That's why I think it is using four tasks to process the data. In Spark 1.6, it used to invoke only one task by default, or I might be wrong. It might be using two tasks there also. Anyway, you can see that by default there are two executors to process this data, and when we as part of each executor, by default it is using two tasks to process the data, and hence at each stage there are four tasks to process the data. You can go to jobs here, and then you can see there are three stages with respect to jobs, and each of these stages have different number of tasks to process the data. Okay, you can actually go here. So total there are not three actually, there are six stages. As part of first stage there are four tasks, as part of second stage there are four tasks, as part of third stage there are four tasks, so on and so forth. So total there are 24 tasks to process this data. Okay, that being said, to process this data, which is only few megabytes, it is actually taking a lot more capacity than it should be. Okay, so for this data volumes which we are talking about, it is enough to process data with one executor and one very less memory and one executor core. We don't need to use this much of resources.